an England plane.
I think Will was asking if you'd let him into the meeting.
I don't know. Should we?
I don't know. It's up to you. It's up to you, boss.
Let's put it to a vote. All right. Where is he? I don't see him.
He sent a picture. It said, you have to let him in.
Well, he's not showing the participants.
Huh.
So he must be somewhere else. He should be in the waiting room.
He said, please wait. The meeting host will let you in soon. I told him to restart it.
Tell him to go to the waiting room.
Does he have to talk to your secretary to get in the meeting?
Well, I mean, we didn't vote yet. So, what is this? Wow, look at all these people. All right. So, tell him to go to the waiting room where you usually go, and I will invite him in. He needs to come first.
Did you see Wells Fargo is back at it again? Yep. With the payment protection program or whatever?
Mm-hmm. Well, that's what it is.
They just can't go a single year without being corrupt, can they?
No. Well, it's the name of the game. All right. So here it is. Here is Will. All right.
I'm just standing here.
Everybody here? Everybody?
Sir.
All right. So we were talking about the last aspect of Lagrangian mechanics, which is how do you deal with constraints? Okay? Because if a force doesn't do work, it doesn't appear in the kinetic or potential energy. All right? We agree on that?
Yes.
So, for instance, if I have a block, if I have a block here,
I'm here. I'm catching.
Well, maybe better to draw it as a little. Well, okay. So something here. I'm gonna draw it freehand. Okay. If I have a block on a surface, this is, for instance, an incline or a table that has been tilted. Okay, the force, the normal force that keeps the object from going down into the plane is perpendicular to the motion. Okay, so the motion is in this direction, up and down the plane, and the force is perpendicular, so the normal force doesn't do work, and then, of course, it doesn't appear anywhere. Okay, however, in Newtonian mechanics appears because you need to know the forces to calculate the motion, okay? So, in Lagrangian formulation, the constraint forces, the forces that do not do work, never appear in the Lagrangian, okay? There is no way. Now, in general, that's a good thing, because usually you don't care about the constraint forces. You only care about the equation of motion. How is the object going to move, okay? But if you need to know the force of constraint, you need to do a different formulation. And the formulation is based on this idea. F is the equation of constraint, which basically is an equation in which a relationship between the coordinates equal to zero. And this, for each equation of constraint, K is not the degrees of freedom. K is how many equations of constraint you have. For each equation of constraint, you have a lambda that multiplies how the constraint depends on the coordinate, okay? That lambda plays the role of the constraint force. For that, if you want to find the normal force, you will look at the lambda associated with the condition that the coordinate along the plane is anything but the coordinate perpendicular to the plane has to be always above the plane, okay? So that's a constraint. So for example, let me show you an example of this. in the next page, well, let's first remove this. So, as an example, imagine that you have a disc rolling down a plane, not the block, but the cylinder rolling down a plane, okay? So we know, and why is the coordinate associated with the motion along the plane, okay? We usually call it x, in this problem they call it y, don't worry, okay? So it has kinetic energy due to translation of the center of mass, and kinetic energy due to rotation about the center of mass. You know, this is the 1/2 mv squared, this is the 1/2 I omega squared corresponding to rotation, okay? And the moment of inertia of a cylinder is 1/2 mr squared, so I can write it like this, all right? The potential energy is due to the height, so it's gonna depend on mgh, where h is the vertical distance it changes when it moves from one y to another y. So that will be, and this is the, how long is the plane, okay? And of course, sine of the alpha, alpha is inclination. So we can write t minus u, okay? We can write t minus u, okay? How many degrees of freedom you have? Well, you have two, y and theta, okay? But if you ask that this is done rolling, like it shows here, rolling down the plane, that means that what it moves on the plane and what it rotates are not independent variables. So the condition, of course, is that y is equal to r theta. Whatever distance the center moves is the same distance that basically the border moves, the r theta changes, okay? So there are two ways to deal with that. Since these two coordinates are connected, there really doesn't have 2 degrees of freedom. If the object is rolling, if I know theta, I know y, or if I know y, I know theta, okay? So basically, the conclusion of this is, I could just write only theta, for instance, where it says y, I could put r theta, and then where I put y, and then this will be Lagrangian that depends only on theta, okay? You agree?
Yes.
The correct way to do this will be to treat this variable as given by theta or vice versa. So the two variables are only one, okay? However, I might choose not to do that and treat them as two separate variables that are connected through an equation of constraint. So instead of replacing y by r theta, I can write the equation of constraint as something equal to zero. That's the only requirement. The force, the equation that describes the connection between the coordinates imposed by the constraint has to be equal always to zero. So the equation of the constraint is not y equals r theta. The equation of constraint is y minus r theta is equal to zero. All right? And then we use this idea that I can, for each, we have one equation of constraint, which is y minus r theta equals zero, we differentiate this respect to the coordinates. What are the coordinates? Y and theta. So we have two lambdas, okay? One lambda corresponding to this. So let's see how that plays out, is that we can write this and then write, instead of this term, which is the standard equal to zero, okay? We treat it like there are two equations, like theta and y are independent of each other, okay? And then we add the equation of constraint, which is this one. What is the equation of constraint? Well, in the y equation is how the constraint depends on y, okay? And in the theta equation, how the constraint depends on theta, okay? Now notice lambda is the same in both, because lambda is for each equation of constraint, you have one lambda. Since we have only one equation, there is only one. So this lambda is the same as this lambda. Okay? The multiply. So, what do we do? Well, how does f depend on y? Well, the partial of f respect to y is 1. Okay? We agree? And the partial of f respect to theta is r, negative. No? This is partial, not total.
That is correct.
All right? So this is a 1, and this is a minus r, multiplying lambda. Okay? So now we are treating like there are two independent variables, y and theta, subject to this conditional constraint, and then we end up with this kind of equation. Lambda times 1 here, coming from this term, and minus lambda times r here, coming from this term. Okay? Lambda is the same in both, so if you want, you can try to solve for lambda. But in principle, the only thing you need to know is if I multiply this equation times r, okay, all the terms, and I add them, then lambda drops, and we have an equation where the thing has disappeared. All right? And then we have this constraint. So the idea is that we can replace now, notice the difference. Now we use the fact that they are not independent of each other. If you want, you can think of it as a trick. We should assume they are not, they are independent of each other. We treat it like that with a constraint, and now we use the fact that they do depend on each other. What do you get with all this loop? That you get to calculate lambda that way. What is lambda? Lambda is the force that is responsible for the constraint. Who is the force responsible for the constraint? Well, usually it's going to be the force between the plane and the cylinder. Okay? So you can solve, for instance, and lambda becomes this thing, which if you look at this, this is nothing else than the normal force associated with the problem. All right? So you can figure out that. All right, so the trick is doing that, treating like the two coordinates are not related, are independent of each other, they're 2 degrees of freedom, writing the constraint using the Lagrange multiplier, and that way we can obtain the constraint if we want that. Now, if you don't care about what the normal is or any other force is, then you don't have to do all this. You just reduce this equation, a single equation, where you put y in terms of theta or theta in terms of y. Okay? This is only if you need to know the constraint. For instance, can the plane handle that motion? Maybe it will break, things like that. Okay? So the force of constraint doesn't affect the motion except when it fails, when it cannot do it. Then you need to know that if you're building something, a bridge or something, you need to know, well, is this going to hold? That's not an irrelevant question. Okay? For the motion, it doesn't matter. But for the motion to happen, it has to hold. Okay? So, we will discuss, for instance, other examples later, but you might recognize this problem. Might have seen it. You have seen this problem before?
Oh, yeah. All the time.
All the time. Okay?
Every day.
We put a small object here. We let it slide. And in this case, it's rolling, but you can make it slide only. And then you need to calculate where it's going to land. No? And basically, the idea is that you have the coordinates are only theta. The only coordinate that you need to know is theta to follow the motion around this, because r is constant. But notice, we can suspend that idea for a moment and make r a variable. Like the object can actually move in and out of the plane. Okay? Why do we do that? Because then we have...
It's going to come off the thing.
We have two independent coordinates, r and theta. Okay? We know that r is equal to big r, but we treat it like it's a separate thing to be able to calculate the normal. Why do we need a normal? Because the only way you're going to find out where this thing is going to take off is a condition on the constraint. So if you... if you put here r equals r, if I put here that r is equal to r, so r is not variable, okay, I put it here, solve it, I can solve the motion, but I don't know where the normal will be zero. You understand that? This equation doesn't have the normal anywhere. So the way to include the normal to be able to find the condition is to imagine that the other variable is also variable, the other quantity r is not a constant, it's a variable, And at the end of the problem, we make it a constant. Okay? The only reason to do that is it's going to create a Lagrange multiplier, which is going to let you calculate how much is the normal force at every place while it stays in contact with the surface. Okay? So notice we use little r here, kinetic energy. If r is variable, then it has a radial velocity. Okay? It can move along the radius and along the tangential r theta. Okay? This is the potential energy, standard mgy, minus mgy. And we can write two equations, one for the variable r, I'm calling r as the variable in the kind of temporary variable. It's not a variable, I'm treating it as a variable. Okay? So this equation, I'm treating that the r is a variable, theta is a variable. Okay, r is not a variable, but three other ones. Both have the same lambda. And what is the equation of constraint? Well, what is the equation of constraint? It's this. That's the equation of constraint. Or, remember, I minus r equals zero. Remember, the equation of constraint is always a function equal to zero. And that's the function we differentiate. So does the function depend on r? Yeah. That's one. Okay? The derivative of the function respect to r is a one. The derivative of function respect to theta is zero. The function does not depend on theta. So this is zero, and this is one. Okay? Agree? Do you see what I'm talking about? The equation of constraint is on r only. So the constraint does not depend on theta. So this term drops. And this term is one. So we have a lambda here and nothing here. And then we can combine the two equations with now this knowledge. Okay? So these are the derivatives. These are the full equations. Okay? So basically, the radial equation. And now we make the radius to be the radius constant, R, A, whatever you want to call it, okay? And in that case, what happens? Well, in that case, the second derivative is zero, okay? The first derivative is zero, R is a constant. And basically, I end up with this equation plus lambda and this equation equal to zero. Notice that we do this at the end. So we let r to be a variable, and then we make it a constant. The whole purpose of that is to be able to calculate lambda. Why do we want lambda? Because we want to know at what point the object will be moving so fast that it doesn't have contact with the surface. All right? So, again, we know how to solve this problem using Newtonian mechanics. This is what you get from this equation, where A is the radius. And we can use that and obtain an integral. And the integral is going to be basically some kind of. And eventually, remember this result, that if we want the normal to be zero, okay, that puts a condition, which is basically for cosine of theta equals to third, the normal becomes zero. So that's the last point in which you're going to be moving circularly. After that, you're going to do parabolic motion. All right? So this is the price you pay for not doing Newton's laws. Is if you want to know the forces that are not doing work, you need to create artificially the dependence. You may need to imagine the dependence temporarily to be able to figure out how much force you have to do to keep that variable constant. All right? So, this I'm going to skip is simply how you go from Newton to Lagrange or from Lagrange to Newton. It's interesting. Look it up. It's not a lot of math without much insight. But basically, if you assume Newton's law is correct, you end up with this. Okay? Where L is T minus U. Okay? So the basic idea is, contrary to the Newtonian mechanics, Lagrangian mechanics is not a vector theory. It's a scalar theory. We're dealing with numbers, not with arrows, with vectors, like forces. Okay. The second thing is a general way to approach any problem. The only thing you need to know is what are the degrees of freedom of the problem, associate coordinates with these degrees of freedom, and write the kinetic and potential energies, create the Lagrangian, T minus U, and then apply the Euler-Lagrange equation. Of course, we usually write it the other way, okay? So we usually write this minus that equal to zero, but of course, since it's equal to zero, it doesn't matter what order you do, okay? So that's the stress is in the motion, not in the forces, and because of that, we do a scalar theory instead of a vector theory. Now, to get into the Hamiltonian mechanics, we need to have one more result, which is that because the kinetic energy is written in terms of the position coordinate dot, the velocity, squares in each direction of motion, okay, then you can see that that if you do this calculation, basically, imagine I do it in one dimension so you see the general idea. So let's imagine the kinetic energy in one dimension is 1/2 m h dot square, which is not a terribly revolutionary idea. All right? So what we say is, okay, if I do the derivative of the Lagrangian of the kinetic energy respect to the velocity, it's dot, what do I get?
You get the acceleration.
No, not respect to the velocity. Okay, so if the kinetic energy is 1/2 mv squared, and I differentiate respect to v, what do I get?
You just get mx double dot.
Well, the derivative is simply mx dot.
Okay,
I'm doing the derivative, I'm not doing the rate of change of the derivative. So if I multiply now,
mx dot.
If I multiply mx dot times s dot, what do I get? Mx dot, which is what I differentiated against, times s dot, which is that term. What do I get?
Mx
dot squared, which is what? It's twice what I started with. Okay, so it's dot squared m, but without the 1/2. So basically, because the kinetic energy depends with the square of the velocity, when I differentiate the square, I drop the factor 1/2. And if I multiply mv times v, I get twice the kinetic energy. You see that? Okay, so when I do this calculation, writing the kinetic energy in terms of the generalized coordinates and calculate the rate of change of the kinetic energy with the coordinate velocity and multiply the velocity for all the coordinates, r, theta, phi, h, y, z, whatever is the system, what I get is twice the kinetic energy. Okay, I did it for a simple one-dimensional case, but if this will be a two-dimensional case, what would you say? Well, you will say that this is that plus 1/2 m y dot square, okay? And what is the derivative of the kinetic respect to h dot? Mx dot. What is the derivative of the kinetic energy respect to y dot? Is what? My dot.
My dot.
Yeah? So if I multiply h dot times mx dot, I get this, mx dot square. If I multiply y dot times my dot, what do I get? My dot squared.
My dot squared.
So basically, when I add the two, I get twice the kinetic energy. So it doesn't matter how many coordinates you use, because you are differentiating respect to each coordinate. So what is the general idea? Is that it's a special case of a general case. Believe it or not, it was due to Euler, completely separate of this, which is if you have a function that is homogeneous of a certain power, meaning that the function depends to a certain power of the variable, then when you differentiate respect to that variable, which is what we are doing here, when differentiating respect to whatever variable you have, what is going to drop? An n. And what's going to happen is going to be n f n minus 1. No? If f is a nth power of a variable, then this is going to be n f minus 1. You multiply this times the variable, or y, whatever is the coordinate, x to the n minus 1. You multiply times x, and you get back x to the n. So the difference between the function and differentiating respect to the variable and multiplying to the variable is a factor n, where n is the homogeneity of the degree of homogeneity. So if the function depends on the coordinate square, you get 2t or 2f. If the function depends on the coordinate cube, then you get three functions. Okay? So basically n appears as a factor if you do this combination. Rate of change explicit respect to the coordinate times the coordinate. It's an Euler theorem. It's a general idea that you can clearly see that it works in simple cases, but it works for any function that is homogeneous. Homogeneous means that all the terms depend on the same power. Okay? All right. So, what do we need this? Because then we're going to use this relationship that calculating this is the same as getting twice the kinetic energy. Where is going to happen? Well, when we discuss the Hamilton formulation, that's going to be an important calculation. Why? Well, we can look at the conservation of energy in those terms. So let me clear all drawings. Okay, so conservation of energy. Okay, so what happens if the Lagrangian depends on position and velocity, but does not depend explicitly of time? That's the condition. What happens if the Lagrangian does not explicitly of time? Well, we can clearly see that in that case, it doesn't matter when I start describing the problem, the equation will always be the same. Okay? It doesn't matter if I do resolve the problem now and in 30 minutes, the equation of motion will be the same. Okay? So what is the rate of change of the Lagrangian? Well, the Lagrangian is a function, remember. The Lagrangian is a function of the coordinates of the derivatives of the coordinate respect to time and of time. Possibly. Now we are saying is it doesn't depend explicitly on time. There is no t in the expression of the Lagrangian. There is only q and q dot. Okay? So in that case, I don't need to include the LDT here. Okay? This is how the Lagrangian depends on the coordinate times how the coordinate depends on time. This is how the Lagrangian depends on the q dot times how the q dot depends on time, which is q double dot. This is simply chain rule. Okay? If the Lagrangian depends on q and q dot, the rate of change on the Lagrangian can be obtained by how does it change with q times how q changes with time, and how does it change with q dot times how q dot depends on time, which is the q double dot. Okay? And then we use the fact that this term here, okay, if it satisfies the Euler equation, can be replaced by this term. Okay? I can put this here. Okay? What is the advantage of that? Well, the advantage of that is to find a certain thing that will not change with time, that this will be zero. Okay? And the idea, Okay, we are here. So we can replace that term here, and we have this relationship. And basically what we are saying is, what is this? What is the right-hand side? Well, it has two terms. It has Q dot. We lost Andrew, and he's coming back. Okay, so we have two terms.
Yeah, I think something happened to his Wi-Fi.
Okay. So,
hey, yeah, my Wi-Fi just glitched.
Okay. So one term is Q dot, derivative with respect to time. The other term is derivative with respect to Q dot times Q double dot. Well, that can be written as the rate of change of this combination. You can see if I expand this by the product rule, this will be Q double dot times this, which is that term, plus Q dot times the derivative with respect to time, which is this term. Okay? And this is supposed to be minus that, supposed to be zero, because dldt is that. Okay? So once you put everything together, what we're saying is there is a derivative with respect to time here, there is a derivative with respect to time here, I can do the derivative of the parenthesis, okay? And if the derivative of the parenthesis is zero, means that the parenthesis is a constant. So we found that when the Lagrangian is independent explicitly of time, there is a quantity that is a constant, okay? What is that quantity? Well, wouldn't be surprised that it's associated with the energy, okay?
Negative H.
Yeah, negative H. So this quantity is negative H. H, in this case, happens to be also the kinetic energy. But in general, we call H at this
combination. The Hamiltonian?
Yeah, the Hamiltonian is velocity times the Lagrangian respect to the velocity minus Lagrangian. No, this is minus H, okay? So, oops. So you need to be careful that is minus H, not H, what we have found. All right. So the other two conservation theorems are important, but I'm not going to focus on them. Conservation of linear angular momentum, I just want to mention. But the general idea is this. We have this thing that has to be constant. Okay? So this has to be zero. And we just figured out that if the Lagrangian is t minus u, and u does not depend on the velocity, okay, then this is the same than the derivative of t, the kinetic energy respect to the velocity, because the derivative of the potential respect to the velocity is usually zero. Most potentials do not depend on the velocity, depend on the position. So in those cases, what happens? Well, this happens to be 2t, okay? This combination becomes 2t. Remember, differentiate the kinetic energy respect to the velocity times the velocity gives you twice the kinetic energy. So what do you end up having? You end up having that L minus 2t equals zero is constant. And what is L minus 2t? Well, L minus 2t is
Messi, what kinetic, do you think?
Kinetic minus potential minus 2t. What is
that? H.
Is t plus u.
Benji, what do you think? I haven't heard from you in weeks, man.
All right. So that's the definition. There is a function called the Hamiltonian. There is a function called the Hamiltonian that basically is constant if the Lagrangian does not depend on time. So when does the Lagrangian depend on time? Well, for instance, if I have a pendulum, and I pull from the string, okay, then the length of the string will depend on time. Then, in that case, I don't expect that the energy will be constant. Why? Because I'm doing work by pulling the string. If I don't pull the string, then the string doesn't do work because it's perpendicular to the motion. But if I shorten the string, then now I'm pulling inwards, I'm doing work. Okay? If the object moves in the direction of the force, it's doing work. So the general idea is that there are rules under which the Hamiltonian is equal to the energy. When can you expect that instead of writing the Lagrangian as t minus u and calculating this quantity that we just discussed, this quantity, yes. Instead of calculating H as this minus that, see, this is minus H, okay? Instead of calculating all this, I can just simply write, instead of the Lagrangian being T minus U, I can say the Hamiltonian is T plus U, okay? So I don't have to go through the Lagrangian. I can just simply write the Hamiltonian as the expression of the energy, kinetic plus potential, all right? When can you do that? Which is a nice shortcut. When can you do that? Well, the potential cannot depend on the velocity, because that was the assumption we did to say that when we differentiate the Lagrangian respect to the velocity, the potential doesn't contribute. Okay? So we need the potential to be independent of the velocity. Okay? So we can throw du, the derivative of u respect to the velocity. And on the other side, what we need is that the equations that transform the motion, basically the transformation, from the total rectangular xyz to the, your generalized coordinates, let's say theta, whatever it is, must be independent of time. Okay? So if the equation, the transformation is independent of time, then it's true that the kinetic energy but will depend on the velocity squared. Okay? If this is not true, then there are time-dependent terms that screw up it. All right? So these are two separate questions. One is, when is h equal to v? When can I just simply write h as t plus u? That's one possibility. The other question is, when is the energy constant? Separate thing. Okay? Okay, when is the energy constant? Okay, and they are not equivalent. The Hamiltonian can be equal to the energy, and the energy might be changed. Okay? All right? Or the Hamiltonian might not be equal to the energy. Okay? Depending on the situation. Okay? So we have cases in which H is not equal to E, but the energy is constant. And then we also have situations in which H is not equal to E. All right? Now, the other two concern quantities. Somebody's. Do I have extra sound somewhere?
It's probably me. I'll put it on mute.
Okay. Okay. So, the other two constants is energy, linear momentum, angular momentum in Newtonian mechanics. In Lagrangian mechanics, it's the same. And the idea is if the. Basically, if you have a system and you translate as a whole the system, it to a different place, okay, if the result is independent of where you put it, then linear momentum should be conserved. All right? So basically what we're saying is it doesn't depend of a uniform displacement of the whole system. And then angular momentum is associated with the fact that if I rotate the coordinate system, okay, or the system itself, then if the Lagrangian does not change, then we say that angular momentum is conserved. So basically what we are looking for is the things I can do to a system that the Lagrangian is not affected by. All right? So I'm not going to spend time on this, but these are demonstrated as that angular momentum is constant if the Lagrangian is not dependent of the orientation of the coordinate system. Okay, so let's go to Hamilton's dynamics, okay? So this is Hamilton equations. So the first thing we do is recognize that when we apply Lagrangian mechanics, we have to calculate two partials, no? We have to calculate the partial of the Lagrangian respect to x and the partial of the Lagrangian respect to x dot, okay? For each coordinate, x, y, z, r, theta, whatever is your coordinate, you have to do it with. Now, the derivative of the Lagrangian respect to the velocity, we know what it gives. Okay? If the Lagrangian is 1/2 mh dot squared, what is, and the kinetic energy is the only term that depends, what you get is mv. No? We agree on that? Let's just write the form.
Yeah, if the kinetic energy, that.
If the kinetic energy is 1/2 mv squared in a particular direction, okay, then the derivative of the Lagrangian respect to the velocity is simply mv. Okay, I drop the 2, I get mv. So we call that the moment. Okay, we call that the moment. What happens if the Lagrangian is not expressed in linear coordinate? It might depend on theta, like independent. It will be theta dot squared. Well, you don't get then the same, you don't get en tetalot. Okay, because tetalot is Kaznoyun. You get some length and tetalot. This is what we call this generalized momentum. Okay, so generalized momentum is what you get when you differentiate t minus u respect to the velocity. In Cartesian coordinates, it corresponds to the standard linear momentum. If the coordinate is an angle, this will be derivative respect to theta dot. Okay, notice what happens. If I have, these are the two typical things. Either you write the kinetic energy in terms of the coordinates, or you can use it in terms of angles, you know, cylindrical, spherical coordinate, whatever. So the idea is that the idea is this. Let's say that the kinetic energy of a pendulum can be written as 1/2 m, and the velocity is what? Well, the velocity is the length of the pendulum times the angular velocity theta dot, okay, square. Okay? That will be the kinetic energy of a pendulum in terms of the angle that the pendulum makes with the vertex. We agree on that?
That is correct.
All right. So that's the tangential velocity, radius times angular velocity. Tangential velocity times 1/2 m, that's the kinetic energy. All right. So what happens when I differentiate this respect to theta dot? What do I get? What do I get when I do the derivative of the kinetic
ML energy? ML theta a dot. Yeah.
Yeah. And what is that? Is
ML, that's the angular velocity, right?
Well, the whole thing is what? The derivative of T respect to theta, which is what we are talking about here, dot, is going to be, this is 1/2 m L squared theta dot squared. No? So the derivative is going to drop the 2 with a 1/2 m.
So it's just L ML squared theta.
Yeah.
Theta dot. Okay? Agree?
Oh, L squared, yeah.
You have a square.
What do you think? Do you agree?
We agree?
That makes sense, yes.
Anybody objects?
I think he made his face to the background.
So what is this? This is L. L theta dot, what is that? Is the mass times the velocity times the distance. What is that? Well, the mass times velocity is the momentum. Times the distance, what do you get when you play distance times momentum?
Speed.
No.
I don't know. I feel like this is a really easy question.
Very easy.
Andrew, you should know the answer to this.
We need help from me.
He doesn't want to tell you. It's so easy. He wants to give you a chance to shine. Okay, so shine. Mind you, do you want to shine? What has the units of mass times length times velocity?
Work.
So if I write it like this, what is this? This is the momentum. Yeah. When I multiply the momentum times the length, what is that? What quantity you get by multiplying momentum times length? There is linear momentum. What's the other momentum?
I said angular, but you said it was wrong. Angular momentum.
I never said it was wrong. I just said, what is it?
Oh, I said angular momentum, and you said no.
The angular momentum, you can call it L, you can call it L. I don't want to call it big L, because then it's Lagrangian, okay?
I said angular. MVR.
It's like the angular, it's MVR. It's the momentum times the lever arm. Now, if you have a pendulum, the velocity, tangential, is V. The lever arm is L. L times MV, that's the basically, the r vector p, the distance cross the momentum, that's what we call angular moment. Let's call it, I don't know, like this, angular moment. I'm going to write this, so it's not the Lagrange. All right? So when I multiply the momentum times his lever arm, I get angular momentum. So in other terms, if the variable is a linear variable, like x, y, z, the momentum is the standard momentum mv. But if the coordinate is an angle, instead of a Cartesian coordinate, it's an angle, then what I get is not the linear momentum, what I get is the angular momentum. So linear coordinates produce linear momentum, angular coordinates produce angular momentum. Pretty easy to remember. All right? This is why it's called generalized momentum, because it could be a linear momentum, it could be an angular momentum. They don't even have the same units, okay? Every time I differentiate the Lagrangian respect to the rate of change of the coordinate, I get the momentum. If the coordinate is linear, I get the linear momentum. If the coordinate is angular, I get the angular. That's why it's called generalized. Okay? And if I differentiate about something else, I get something else that is going to be some kind of momentum. I don't know what kind of. All right? So, based on this, you can write the Euler condition as what? Well, what did we say? What is the equation for the Euler equation? The derivative of the Lagrangian, respect.
The Q by dp dl dq dot.
Yes, you are on fire today. You are
on fire. Always on fire.
It's always on fire.
Top of this stuff.
It's the beans behind me, they're giving okay. me knowledge.
And what is this? This is what we call P. The derivative of Lagrangian respect to the velocity is what we just call P. So, what we are saying is the derivative respect to time of P equals dl dq, which is that term. You see that?
Yes.
So, with this definition of P, the Euler equation can be written like this.
Dude, Minji, what did you put on your Instagram story?
What?
Nothing. You put it on there like a couple
Let's
hours
finish ago. This and then you can talk all you want. Okay, so.
We're busy here, Andrew.
Yeah, we don't have time for that. All right, so what's the moral of the story? Well, the moral of the story is that I can go back here and say, okay, I can write the momentum like this as a definition. This is, notice the three lines. This is a definition. It's nothing new. We call the derivative of Lagrangian respect to the Q dot, we call it momentum. And we use the symbol P because it's a symbol for momentum. Based on this definition, the standard Euler equation becomes this. ddt dl dq dot equals dl dq. Do you agree?
That is correct.
Instead of saying equal to zero, we say one is equal to the other. All right? Now, what do I need to do this? Is remember how the Hamiltonian was calculated. Remember that when we calculated, discussed the Hamiltonian here. The function h is this thing, is the sum of this minus L. Okay? So basically when we go back here, I can write Lagrangian like this, where P is dl dq dot, okay, times q dot. Is what we had before, okay? All right, so this is how the Hamiltonian is calculated.
Did y'all just lose sound?
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, man, we can't hear you.
We can't hear you.
Can you, if you can hear us,
sound cut off.
He's gonna keep talking. Hold on, I'll message him.
It might be because we're over the time limit.
Dude, what they put in that, what they sent you, he said, hello.
What?
The message I sent.
Yeah.
That had to have been a call or something.
Can't wait to write my term paper.
Let me just submit my poster.
Are you almost done?
Dude, I just started. I have to change my seminar.
Huh?
Ashbin?
I have to change my seminar.
What, today?
That's a little late now.
Like a couple weeks ago. It's been like 2 weeks.
Ashbin? You think he can hear us?
No, I don't think he can because we asked him to wave if he can.
Yo, this.
He's still teaching, Dr. man. Hello.
Dude, he's still teaching. Maybe if we go out and try to rejoin.
I mean, it's time though.
Yeah.
It's time, all right. So.
He's still.
Dr. Ben. Trying to get his attention.
That's what I'm trying to do.
Thank you for letting me know.
All right. There we go.
All right. So, yeah, when it gets to the time that it's supposed to end, which is 4, it shuts off. Regardless if I'm talking or not, so I need to remember. All right, so P is the LDQ dot. That's that term. What is Q dot? Okay, so if you have a one-dimensional problem, what is going to be the calculation? Well, H in a one-dimensional problem, the only coordinate set, is going to be the momentum, mv, that's the momentum, times the velocity, v, minus the Lagrangian. As you can see, that's twice the kinetic energy. Mv squared is twice the kinetic energy. Okay? Minus T minus U, which is T plus U. Minus the parenthesis is minus T plus U. 2T minus T is T, and you get T plus U. So if you have a one-dimensional problem, writing all this mess is the same as writing kinetic potential. All right? But in general, you don't expect this to be always equal to kinetic potential. This is not always T plus U. In many cases it is, in many others it's not. Okay? But the equations are written not in terms of the energy T plus U, but in terms of the function, which sometimes is equal to T plus U, and sometimes is not equal to T plus U. All right? All right. So what do we do? Well, we write these things in terms of the Hamiltonian now, instead of respect to the Lagrangian. And that's the key difference. So how do you do that? Well, basically, we write it like this, and we'll stop. The Hamiltonian, remember what we did before, was to write it as this, P times V minus L, okay? Momentum times velocity minus Lagrangian. Momentum times velocity. For each coordinate that you have, K is how many degrees of freedom you have. for each degree of freedom of the problem, you have a coordinate and a momentum, and this is the way the total quantity is calculated. Okay? So basically, momentum times velocity minus Lagrange. Okay? So, you can see because of this form that if the rate of change of the Hamiltonian now, okay, is due because the Hamiltonian now is a function not of Q, V, and T, Q, Q dot, and T, like the Lagrangian was, Q, Q dot, and T, but is a function of Q, momentum, and T. So the big difference between the Lagrangian and the Hamiltonian is in the Lagrangian we use position and velocity. In the Hamiltonian, the variables are position and momentum. You might say, well, there is just a mass in between. Velocity and momentum doesn't be. But this is generalized momentum. Okay? So it could be also angular momentum. It could be also a third thing that is not in linear and not in angular. Okay? So basically, once we look at that, we do the same thing that with the Lagrangian. How does the Lagrangian change? Well, it changes because Q changes, because Q dot changes, or because it explicitly changes. Okay? This is the same thing. How can the Hamiltonian change? Well, it can change because Q changes, that's that. It can change because P changes, that's that. Okay? And it can change because it depends on time explicitly. All right? So we can use this basically expression and put these terms, what is the partial of the Hamiltonian respect to Q? Okay, where is the Hamiltonian respect to Q? Well, the Hamiltonian depends to Q respect to Q here. Okay, and what did we call the derivative of Hamiltonian respect to Q and P? And after writing this and doing a lot of massaging with Lagrangian and everything, you end up with a expression which is this basically. And these are the Hamilton equations of motion. Okay? So these are the two first order differential equations instead of the second order differential equation for each k is each degree of freedom. Okay? So what is this? If I take the Hamiltonian, imagine the Hamiltonian is written in the way you see it in mechanics, you write the Hamiltonian in terms of the kinetic energy, and the Hamiltonian, instead of being written as 1/2 mv², you know, T plus U, when is equal to T plus U, I give you an example, okay? T is always written as 1/2 mv², no? Plus U, but you don't use velocity in Hamiltonian, you use momentum. So in terms of momentum, what is 1/2 mv².
Mv times v dot or whatever.
No. Right? How do you write this in terms of p?
PV
in terms of mv.
No, it's just pv.
No, is p squared. And now I have extra m, so I have to remove the m.
P squared over m, 2m.
P squared over 2m. Okay, so this is how you write the kinetic energy in terms of the momentum instead of in terms of the velocity, okay, plus potential. Okay, so when I do the derivative of the Hamiltonian, remember, to be able to do the part the explicit, you have to express the quantity in terms of that. So if I put D here and I differentiate respect to P, D and P are different variables, okay? So I need to first write the Hamiltonian in terms of the momentum and the position. Then I look at how the Hamiltonian depends on the momentum now. How does it depend on the momentum? What is dH dP? What is this dH dP?
Just P over M.
Velocity. P over M, which is?
Velocity.
So that's what this equation says. That the velocity, Q dot, is the how the Hamiltonian depends on P. You see that? Why can we do that? Well, because the potential energy does not depend on the momentum. So when I do this, the potential energy might depend on the position, but not on the velocity. So when I do this, this doesn't contribute. Okay? So in other terms, if I write the Hamiltonian and I differentiate respect to P, I get the velocity. If I have the Hamiltonian and I differentiate respect to Q, by definition, I get minus the rate of change of P. Do you see why is that?
Yes.
When I do dTh dQ, okay, I get is the same than the U change of sign respect to Q. And that's, remember, is the definition of generalized momentum. So anyway, when we try to remember these two quantities, notice the symmetry. P appears here, Q appears here. Q appears here, P appears here. So it's like a pair of variables in which basically there is no real difference between P and Q. Okay? So if I differentiate respect to P, I get Q dot. If I differentiate to Q, I get P dot. So this is like a machine to produce differential equations. Okay? Now, the only thing that screws up the remembering is where does the negative go? Okay? Where does the negative go? The way I remember it is, remember what all this is. In the case in which A, H is written like this, 1/2 mv squared plus u, okay, what do you get when differentiating respect to q? Well, this doesn't have a q, okay? This is p, okay? What is the derivative of the potential respect to q? What is the derivative of the potential respect to x, to a coordinate? What is that? By definition,
potential with respect to x?
Yeah, the derivative of the potential respect to x is what?
Just mg?
No, no. In general, what is equal to? If I have a potential differentiated respect to coordinate, I get what in Newtonian mechanics? Let's say if my potential is mgy and I differentiate respect to y, what do I get?
Mg.
What is that mg?
Gravity.
Just like a force?
What quantity is mg?
Force.
It's momentum, it's force. Okay? It's force. But it's not force, it's minus force. Okay? The force is minus the gradient of the potential. That's the general rule in classical mechanics. The force is minus the gradient, sorry about the big del, of the potential. Okay? That's the definition. The connection between potential and force is if you take the gradient of the potential, it gives you the force as a separate sign. All right? So that's why you get the negative. Because what is P dot? P dot is the rate of change of momentum. What is P dot? Is the force. So minus the force, that's that. Minus P dot, minus the force, is equal to du dx. That's the way I remember that which equation has the negative. The equation that has, basically, you will put the minus on this side. Okay? So you'll say, well, one equation is, if I take the Hamiltonian and I differentiate respect to P, I will get M over V, P over M, which is V. That's that. That's easy to remember. So you think of the simplest possible case in which the Hamiltonian is P squared over 2M plus something that doesn't have P. So the derivative of Hamiltonian respect to P is going to be the velocity. We agree on that?
Yes.
That's what we did here. The derivative of Hamiltonian respect to P is P over M, which is the velocity.
Yes.
All right? So that's one equation. The other one is the force equation. The derivative of Hamiltonian respect to Q is associated with the force, and P dot is minus the force. Minus P dot is minus the force. Force in the S direction. In other terms, this is this will be the equation of motion of Newton's second law. And this is how the velocity is calculated if you follow this formulation. What's the advantage of this method? Well, first, mathematically, it's easier to solve two first-order differential equations than a second-order differential equation. Okay? The other thing that is important is that P, PK, and QK form a pair of coordinates, if you want, or a pair of variables that are conjugate. It's called conjugate, when you can interchange them from one to the other. They are not the same thing, but they form a pair. The Q and P are called conjugate variables. Okay? And what does it mean? Well, for instance, in statistical mechanics, how do we describe a particle in statistical mechanics? Well, a particle can be somewhere in the neighborhood of a certain region, let's say in a little Q, with dH, dy, dz. Okay? The particle can be at some points in space in a certain region, very small volume defined by dH, dy, dz. Now, a particle inside there now can move in any direction. It can move in the dH, it could be moving in the dz. Imagine this is a molecule of gas. I can tell you what is the probability that it's going to be in a certain volume, and then the probability that it will be moving in a certain direction. So we have a second cube, which is a cube of velocities. No? Any molecule can be anywhere with any speed, any velocity. So you have three positions, three cues, and three p's. Okay? You have the xyz coordinates and the vx, vy, vz, or px, py, vz. You understand that the particle can be here with any moment. So these are separate quantities. Okay? So what is the general description of a particle? Well, it's a six-dimensional space. So particles are described in physics using a six-dimensional space that is called the phase space, which is has three coordinates and three velocities, or more precisely, three momenta. Sure. So if I want to know what the particular particle is doing, I have to tell you where it is in the xyz and which way it's going in the xyz. That's six data points per particle. Okay? So if I have a Avogadro number of particles in a gas, each of the 10 to 23rd molecule or particle exists in a certain six-dimensional volume, in the neighborhood of a certain xyz, and in the neighborhood of a certain px, py, pz. And all statistical mechanics, which is a gigantic field, is based on this idea. Now, what you need to figure out is how a particle goes from one cell in six-dimensional space that has three coordinates in three momenta to another cell that has a different position and a different velocity. And all statistical mechanics is how to describe how it's going to do that transformation, how the particle that was here at this momentum will end up here with some other moment. All right? That's the basics of statistical mechanics. And basically, is when we treat a large number of particles, that's what we like to describe. What is the probability that if I look at a certain place in space, I'm going to find a molecule traveling in a particular direction with a particular speed? Okay? That's the most information I want. All right, we went too far today, so we'll stop here. And basically, we're going to have the quiz on Friday. And on Monday, we're going to talk about problems associated with solving the motion using the Hamiltonian formulation.
So is Hamiltonian not going to be on the quiz?
No, this chapter is not going to be in the quiz.
What is it just after?